One of the hottest words in the data space today is the term analytics engineer. It's basically on every job posting I see for a data team is hiring some sort of analytics engineer. Zoom back a few years ago, this term didn't even really exist. And the company that is known for having created this term or co-created or at least pioneered this sort of movement of analytics engineering is a company called DBT that used to be called Fishtown Analytics. And it's a super hot startup right now. It's been growing at a rapid rate. They not only have a very popular open source project, one of the most popular in the data engineering space, but they're also growing super fast as a company and are valued at many billions of dollars at this point. So before I dive into the whole analytics engineering world of DBT and what's going on there, I think it's helpful to just think about what was actually happening in the data space at the time that DBT took off. So first and foremost, Snowflake was rising in popularity at a crazy rate. Suddenly, everyone had access to very easy to use, easy to manage, enterprise-grade data infrastructure that previously only some of the largest companies in the world could operate, and still might be worse. There was also this big shift happening sort of as a result of Snowflake, as well as the broader, cloud data warehouse technologies, from this idea of ETL to ELT. ETL stands for, extract, transform, load. ELT is just flipping two of the letters. So it's, extract, load, transform. The difference being that you're actually transforming data after you load into the warehouse instead of before. And what I mean by transforming is changing raw data. And a lot of this transformation previously had to be done in complex tools that, didn't use languages like SQL, but they had super crazy programming like interfaces you would poke around or their own sort of domain specific languages that you would define your data transformations in. And they would run in an engine that was outside of the data warehouse or, happening outside the data warehouse. Or you would code this all directly in something like your Python scripts that you're writing ETL in. But with Snowflake, companies started to realize that they could actually transform data with SQL once it had landed in the data warehouse, just because how scalable cloud data warehouse technologies were at being able to run all sorts of different workloads, whether it's analytics or transformation or anything. So with this huge shift to Snowflake, how do I modernize my data warehouse stack as an enterprise? How do I move to the cloud? How do I think about things like ELT and self-service BI and all these new cool things with data? There became not only a trend of companies and data leaders trying to flock to this new model, but also almost a gold rush of consultancies trying to get into the space and help companies with the process of these cloud data migrations and Snowflake implementations and learning about all the new ways to do data engineering and analytics at companies. And one of the companies that started to carve a name out for itself during this time was at the time, little known consultancy called Fishtown Analytics, which was founded by Tristan Handy and Drew Bannon. So as Fishtown took on more and more and more projects around, implementing Snowflake, getting people over to cloud, they began to notice a pretty common problem across data teams. Specifically, that problem was around how companies did data modeling and data transformation. So again, going from that state of raw data, and once it's in a data warehouse like Snowflake, actually getting it into the format that business users would start querying in BI tools like Tableau or Power BI. And the big thing that they noticed was that there was kind of no standardization with regards to how companies were doing this modeling and transformation. Again, there were tons of legacy tools and processes and stuff like that that companies were doing in the pre-Snowflake era. In the post-Snowflake era, some companies were continuing to use those tools, but they didn't really feel like the right UX once you had this amazing data warehouse that was super powerful. You could run SQL in a breeze with and things wouldn't be taking hours and days. Why should they take that long with your transformation tool in that world? Likewise, a lot of companies realized that Snowflake was a different technology and started to roll out their own systems, kind of match this paradigm of ELT versus ETL, where you could actually use SQL to manage all your transformations. But a lot of these companies that were doing that, didn't have a great way to version control that SQL or manage dependencies between different tables or SQL queries that were going to run in the data warehouse. A lot of people were just rolling out their sort of own tools. And I know this firsthand, back at my previous job at Segment, we kind of wrote our own version, a SQL runner for transformations before DBT came to the market. What Tristan and Drew realized was that every company was kind of writing their own tools for this. this, and that there was a missing standard tool for this new Snowflake and ELT era. And they ended up actually building some internal tools. First one being called, you know, DBT or data build tool that could streamline these processes for their clients while they were operating as a consultancy firm at Fishtown Analytics. DBT started out as a, you know, pretty simple command line tool that effectively allowed you to define a bunch of transformations you wanted to do on your data sets in the data warehouse as a series of SQL statements, and just had a standard way of organizing these, saving them, iterating on them with version control and tools like GitHub. You know, over time, you know, Tristan and Drew at Fishtown realized that this was actually a valuable tool to the rest of the data ecosystem. They ended up open sourcing it so that others could use it. And the open source project started to get more and more traction and get a community sort of revolving around it, to the point that they actually transitioned it from just a side project by the consultancy to a full-on company, renamed as DBT, and raised about $150 million. Tristan actually wrote a really, really good blog post describing the evolution of Fishtown Analytics to DBT. So what is DBT? So DBT is basically a tool that if you're a data team and you want a standard way to manage all the transformations that you're going to do on your data, especially in the world where people are just dumping raw data into the data warehouse and then looking to figure out how to transform it, DBT is a standard way to manage that. And the nice parts about it are, A, they bring the kind of software engineering best practices to the data world. A lot of times what I saw before the world of DBT was that companies just didn't use things like Git or pull requests or, you know, actually writing down some of these transformations in code versus just creating random views and, you know, materialized tables and different things like that in the data warehouse. And with DBT, all that's standardized in a way that's really easy to understand. So effectively what DBT does, democratize the world of data transformation and big chunk of the work that was done by data engineering teams. Not all of it, but a big chunk of it, creating this new role of analytics engineer. And lastly, DBT has a lot of features around just collaboration. By adopting things like version control, and, you know, later they actually built a whole cloud product around this too that a lot of companies have started adopting. This really allows data analysts to collaborate with each other more effectively, for people to suggest changes to each other's models. And all of this really wasn't super easy to do before DBT, frankly. So just to summarize things, the real value of DBT is that it brings some of the software engineering best practices that exist for managing, you know, production code, and it brings them to the data world in a way that's accessible by the largest population of people across the whole data world, which is analysts that know SQL. Someone once told me that, you know, to make an open source business really work, you have to give away way more than you're comfortable with and almost make a big sacrifice on your business itself. You know, when DBT was initially founded, it was just kind of a side project of Fishtown Analytics, the consultancy. It was a tool they were using, and their main business was actually billing, you know, consulting hours and billing projects to clients. Open sourcing it was sort of a no-brainer at the time. But later on, as DBT, you know, became a business and venture-funded business, they stuck with their initial premise of keeping the core product as open source. They ended up building a great cloud product on top, which has a code editor for data analysts and a lot of out-of-the-box orchestration features, and they're adding more and more awesome capabilities to it. But the core of the product is open source, which means a large population of people could adopt it without having to pay anything just to get started. I think DBT was actually one of the first companies in the data space to create a dedicated community for data practitioners of all types, you know, analysts, data engineers, analytics engineers, data leaders, that actually had a community sentiment towards it and, you know, fostered things like knowledge sharing. And it became a place where the DBT Slack community was one of the, you know, the fastest growing Slack communities in the data space, and really became a place where people would get together and share all types of learnings or questions about anything in the data stack, not just DBT. And that was also something that I think just, you know, analysts and data engineers and data people all around the world had a lot of pent up demand for. Is DBT worth all the hype? You know, as a technology, it's quite clear that there's sort of the new standard or the lingua franca when it comes to data modeling.